And welcome to the sixth meeting of the Education and Skills Committee in 2019. Can I remind everyone present to turn their mobile phones and other devices to silent during the duration of the meeting. Agenda item one is Continuing Care Scotland Amendment Order 2019, and we are it's a draft subordinate piece of legislation. It is subject to affirmative procedure. The information about the instrument is provided in paper one of the committee papers. There are two agenda items regarding this. The first, the committee will have an opportunity to ask questions of the Minister and her officials. And after that, we will turn to agenda item two, which is a debate on the motion that is published in the agenda. So can I welcome Maree Todd, MSP, Minister for Children and Young People, David Hannigan, team leader of Looked After Children Unit, and Elizabeth Blair, Senior Principal Legal Officer, Children, Families and Education Division in the Scottish Government. And I'd like to invite the Minister to make an opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, for the opportunity to introduce the draft instrument before the committee today. The Continuing Care Amendment Order amends Article 2 of the Continuing Care Scotland Order 2015 with the effect that from 1st April 2019, the higher age limit for eligible persons specified for the purposes of Section 26A2B of the Children Scotland Act 95 is increased from 20 to 21 years of age. This means that from 1st April 2019, an eligible person for the purposes of the duty on local authorities to provide continuing care under Section 26A of the 1995 Act is a person who is at least 16 years of age and who has not yet reached the age of 21. By virtue of Article 3 of the 2015 order, the local authority's duty to provide continuing care lasts from the date on which an eligible person ceases to be looked after until the date of their 21st birthday. This draft order is essentially a procedural amendment to increase the higher age limit for eligible persons from 20 to 21 years of age and is the final of the agreed annual rollout strategy, increasing the higher age range in step with the first eligible cohort of 16-year-olds, covering all young people who cease to be looked after on or after their 16th birthday to remain in continuing care up to their 21st birthday. This draft order will revoke the Continuing Care Scotland Order 2018. Continuing care and the accompanying secondary legislation stress the importance of encouraging and enabling young people to remain in their care setting until they're able to demonstrate their readiness and willingness to move on to interdependent living. Interdependence more accurately reflects the day-to-day realities of an extended range of healthy interpersonal relationships, social support and networks. Continuing care undoubtedly normalises the experience of care experienced young people in kinship, foster and residential care by allowing strong and positive relationships between young person and carer to be maintained and reducing the risk of multiple simultaneous disruptions occurring in their lives as they approach adulthood. The recent consultation responses have shown that there continues to be widespread support for the policy of continuing care. However, we are listening and we are aware that implementation hasn't happened as intended in every part of the country. There appears to be some inconsistency in approaches being taken by local authorities and, as such, variation in the support being offered to young people leaving care. From engaging with the sector, we know what issues are being faced and where the key barriers are. We're working together to broaden our evidence base and to gather examples of good practice where they exist, to share knowledge and understanding. We'll continue to work collaboratively with stakeholders to consider all evidence and to explore how best to support implementation and to remove any unnecessary barriers to ensure that all care leavers are given the support that is best suited to their individual needs. I'll be happy to take questions.
Thank you, Minister. We do have some questions. I'm going to move to Ms. Lamont.
Okay, just two questions, really, and one is probably related to the key issue, but not the actual core issue itself. You said that there is some evidence that this might not be getting implemented everywhere in the same way. And in your evidence to us, you say you're awaiting the latest publication of national statistics from social work and children looked after in Scotland, which is June 27th March, to assess whether the quality of data will give us an accurate indication of uptake. That sounds like we even at first base in terms of knowing whether the policy is a reality, talked about it being about the real world. We don't even know if the figures we're gathering are going to tell us what's happening. Do you have any idea of what proportion of young people are remaining in foster care or care, continuing care, under the previous order at all?
We do have some idea. I mean, a continuing care category was introduced into the children looked after in Scotland data collection in 2017, and the first full year of data on continuing care has been collected for 2017-18, and it's currently undergoing quality assurance, and that's what will be published at the end of March, subject to the quality assurance process. We will publish aggregated data on continuing care as a destination for those ceasing to be looked after, and we're exploring the feasibility of publishing continuing care figures with a breakdown by local authority. But the information provided through that data collection is only one piece of the puzzle, and we work regularly with local authorities and with our stakeholders in the care sector to improve the collection of information around the uptake and eligibility of continuing care.
Do we know roughly what proportion of young people are remaining in continuing care at 17, 18, 19, 20, roughly?
Do you want to give in?
At the moment, we do not have actual statistics on that. We are waiting to receive the quality assured data on behalf that we have gathered over the last year. Officials have been working with organisations such as Celsus to try and improve the evidence base that we have collected, or we will be collecting going forward, and we're always looking to improve on this. We do not have statistics of the exact numbers in continuing care at the moment.
With respect, you're looking to improve on nothing, because we haven't got anything so far. I mean, I understand this isn't a policy that everybody agrees with, but the policy is the easy bit, the legislation is the easy bit. We can sit here every year and increase it, but the reality on the ground may be very, very different. I mean, I wonder if you would... I'm not sure if you were obliged to bring this order forward before the 27th of March, except you may have done, but I do think there is a question about the gap between what the legislation that we all agree with is asking and the same effort being put into making sure it actually makes a difference on the ground. So I don't know whether we can get a progress report on that. The other question I wanted to ask, which I think is related, which is the review on... support for kinship care and foster care and the whole question of parity. And I know you mentioned in your letter to us the review. I think these things are interrelated, because if somebody's going to continue to be supported, the financial issues around it are connected. Do you think it is reasonable for a review group to meet only three times in 15 months on an issue which is so important?
So we have accepted the recommendations that the review group made, and we're currently working with COSLA to and other partners to fully consider those review recommendations and see what we can do. I think I'm comfortable with how the review group was constituted and how it met, and I'm keen to work with COSLA to see what we can do put forward.
But they've not completed their work.
Do you mean the National Review of Kinship and Adoption Care Allowances?
Yeah.
So that was undertaken by a review group. It published its final report and recommendations last September.
So it's reported last September. Mm-hmm. We have not got anything in front of us that shows that there's progress. This, again, is a fundamental issue, I think, that people across the Parliament supported, which was that there should be parity of esteem and support for kinship care, foster care. And, of course, that's all related to whether people can remain in continuing care. But... It met three times since November 2017, and we're maybe at some point in the future going to do something about it. Do we have a timetable? There's an awful lot of people campaigning very hard to get the recognition of kinship carers. So do we have a timetable for that?
So I'm not sure if we're talking about the same. Are we talking about the review of foster care allowances? Is that what we're talking about? Right. So I can certainly write to you and update you in progress with that. I would say at the moment officials have met with officials from COSLA, to try to consider the recommendations and see what we can do. So I can certainly write to you and update
you
on that.
So you've said that they're going to submit a set of options for your consideration in the summer. So have we got an end point? Do we know at the point by which we will be able to say this scheme will be up and running? And then you could work back from that?
So the foster care allowances, as you understand, are a local authority decision to be made, and I will work very closely with COSLA and
other. Surely the logic of that is then you wouldn't bother having a national review and just be honest about it?
Not at all.
We have agreed that there should be parity between foster carer and kinship carers across the Parliament and elsewhere. Understand the technicalities have to be worked out through COSLA, but you are going to be agreeing an option. You're going to be given options in the summer. Do you have an idea of when we can look to when that scheme will at least be clear to people that local authorities could adhere to or not?
I can certainly write to you and update you on that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. I don't think there are any further questions. So we'll, Rona Mackay, yes.
Thanks. Thanks, Convener. Morning, Minister. I just wonder if you could clarify if the legislation extends to young people in secure residential care, because I was visiting a care unit in my constituency recently, and I was concerned to hear that one young man left at 16 and was going straight into a homeless unit. Excuse me, a homeless unit. So I just wondered how that was going to fit.
So the duty to provide continuing care doesn't apply if the accommodation the person was in immediately before ceasing to be looked after was secure accommodation. And that's for a multiplicity of reasons. For a number of reasons, secure accommodation isn't an appropriate setting for continuing care. When external factors out with that young person's control make continuing care placement unavailable, the local authorities are expected to discuss and to agree alternative support measures which meet that young person's needs.
So it really is the local authority's responsibility?
It is the local authority's responsibility.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Any further questions? Apologies, Ms. Mackay. We now move to agenda item two. Sorry, excuse me. So the agenda item two is Continuing Care Scotland Amendment Order 2019 debate. Can I remind the officials that they are not permitted to contribute to this formal part of the debate, and I invite the Minister to move the motion.
Moved.
Okay. Are there any contributions from members? Yes.
I just want to make the point, I think that the easy bit for us is accepting what's a good policy, but I am concerned that we don't seem to be putting the same amount of effort into establishing whether it's actually making a difference on the ground, both in practical terms for those who are supporting young people and the kind of example that Rona Mackay has given of what it might mean in certain circumstances. So I think I would certainly be looking for reassurance that there is more being done than just simply passing the order, because, you know, if we're doing that, making ourselves feel good, but there's nothing on the ground showing that there's a huge difference in young people's lives, I think that's problematic. And I do recognise what the Scottish Government's doing around the care review, and I've got the utmost respect for the work that's been done there. But I think we would want to be given reassurance that the two things have been brought together.
Any other contributions from members? Would the Minister like to respond to the
comments? I can assure you that I too want to ensure that this policy is properly implemented and that it makes a difference on the ground. And I have my officials working very closely with stakeholders right across the country to ensure that that happens. It's a very high priority for this government, I assure you.
Okay, I now move to the question that motion S5M 15747 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes, thank you. The committee must report to Parliament on the instrument. Are members content for me as convener to sign off a report to the Parliament on this instrument? Thank you. And that concludes our consideration of agenda item two. I would like to thank the Minister and her officials for the attendance at committee this morning, and I'll suspend for a few minutes to let witnesses change over. now move to agenda item 3, Scottish National Standardised Assessments Inquiry. This is our final evidence session on the inquiry, and I can welcome to committee this morning John Swinney, MSP, Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills, Andrew Bruce, Deputy Director, Strategy and Performance, and David Leng, Professional Advisor, Improvement, both from the Scottish Government. And I'd like to invite Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and I welcome the opportunity to contribute to the committee inquiry on the Scottish National Standardised Assessments. When we published the draft National Improvement Framework in 2015, the Scottish Government set out that the SNSA results would help inform teachers' professional judgment of whether children have achieved curriculum for excellence levels, which remains our key and annually published measure in the National Improvement Framework. Judgments which take into consideration the full range of assessment evidence available to teachers. We've been clear throughout that the SNSAs would be introduced for diagnostic purposes to provide teachers with objective, nationally consistent information regarding individual learners' strengths and the areas in which they might benefit from further support. The National Improvement Framework in its entirety is the means by which we wish to review performance at every level in Scottish education, national, local authority and school. In response to a widely accepted recognition that we needed to improve the data on Scottish education, the National Improvement Framework takes a holistic look at the education system, bringing together evidence and information from all levels of the system and across all aspects that impact on performance. The idea is that no one aspect takes precedence. Rather, it's the way in which different parts of the system interact and connect with one another to drive improvement. Within the assessment of children's progress driver itself, children's progress is considered in its widest sense, from development in the early years right through to their destination on leaving school and recognising the primacy of health and wellbeing throughout. I'd like to highlight to committee members the value SNSAs bring to Scottish education, to classroom practitioners and most importantly to children and young people. Assessment has long been recognised in Scottish education as a core aspect of daily learning. The SNSAs were designed specifically for the Scottish curriculum and as such should complement rather than distract from core learning. The information the assessments generate is used by teachers expressly to direct next steps in learning to best effect for the individual learner. We know that the overwhelming majority of local authorities have been using some form of standardised assessments for many years. The SNSAs remove the need for local authorities to buy in those various assessments. They provide at zero cost to local authorities a set of nationally consistent assessments which are for the first time aligned to curriculum for excellence and linked to the literacy and numeracy benchmarks. Comments have been advanced that the SNSAs will tell teachers nothing new. One perspective on that is a strength rather than a weakness, indicating both that the assessments themselves are correctly pitched and that teachers' judgments of individuals' learners' progress are predominantly sound. But equally, comments have been made about the value SNSAs provide in ensuring moderation of performance across the system, resulting in greater confidence within the profession and vital diagnostic information when aspects of assessment outcomes suggest greater or lesser capacity than a teacher has expected. It is certainly the case that SNSAs do not cover all aspects of literacy and numeracy in the curriculum, nor have they been designed to do so. However, attainment in literacy and numeracy has been identified as one of the key priorities within the National Improvement Framework. Literacy and numeracy are the core building blocks for learning across the curriculum, and as such, it is imperative that we identify early on in a child's learning journey any obstacles to their progress in those areas. Committee members have expressed great interest in returning to the Scottish Survey of Literacy and Numeracy, whether as was, as an enhanced version or to run in parallel with the SNSAs. I understand the attraction of that objective. It was, after all, the government's own starting point. As the Scottish Government's evidence to the committee has outlined, we undertook a review of the SSLN in 2014. That review concluded that scaling up the survey model to produce local authority level results was not a viable or realistic option. Essentially because that was not the envisaged purpose of the survey at its inception and the design features of the survey did not lend themselves to that kind of upscaling. In short, it cannot address the deficit in our data identified by the OECD and which the CFE levels data is designed now to address. It remains a strong belief of the Scottish Government that the SNSAs are the right thing to do, that they will bring value to the broad general education in Scotland. fundamentally that they will bring value to children and young people, enabling all learners to reach their potential. That is not to suggest that the assessments at this early stage in their implementation are perfect. Our contract with the assessment providers has built into it the need for continuous improvement. The Scottish Government is alive to the need to continue to work with practitioners to seek feedback and identify means of enhancing the system moving forward. The Primary One Practitioners Forum, the independent inquiry being undertaken by David Reedy, feedback from schools and teachers, and importantly from children themselves, will all help to inform our next steps in that regard. We will strive to improve the operation and communication around SNSAs, and I look forward to the dialogue with the committee as part of that process.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Can I have any questions? Begin with Mr. Gray.
Thanks very much. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. In taking evidence, the committee have asked most witnesses the same question, which is, what's the most important thing in designing an assessment, scheme of assessment? And they've all, in one form or another, I think, given the same answer, perhaps most clearly, Professor Merrill of Durham University, who said the first thing is to be absolutely sure what the purpose of the assessment is. So I'd just like to ask you if you feel that you've always been clear what the purpose of the SNSAs is.
I think that's been the case. That, you know, as I set out in my opening remarks, the purpose of the SNSA is to provide a diagnostic tool to members of the teaching profession, which will allow them to be, or to enhance their confidence about the moderation that they are applying in relation to the performance of an individual child, but then also to identify any particular diagnostic issues that, performance issues that emerge from the diagnosis, that emerges from the SNSA. And so the purpose of the SNSAs, in my view, are, and I think this has been a clearly expressed government approach, has been as a diagnostic tool within the education system.
So these are formative rather than summative?
They are formative, yes.
Okay. Some of our witnesses, I think Professor Bloomer, for example, but certainly the EIS, were strongly of the view that the purpose of the National Standardised Assessments has changed, that they began as a summative, an assessment which was summative and which would give information about the performance of the education system, but that they then changed into formative diagnostic tests.
I don't think that is the case. I've read the EIS evidence on this, and I see the point that they make, but actually in the EIS evidence, the EIS essentially say, although I disagree with the starting point of this, that they started off as summative assessments, they ended up, because of EIS intervention, being formative assessments. So it kind of reinforces my point that whatever they are now, were agreed, the EIS and I are agreed, they're formative assessments. I don't think the government at any stage suggested they should be summative. But what the SNSAs do contribute towards, and again I covered this in my opening statement, is the formulation by a teacher of the information on the achievement of a CFE level, which of course is aggregated at a national level, but that's a separate piece of data which is not, it's informed by the SNSA, but that is only one aspect of the information that is drawn together to formulate that that assessment. Now, where the EIS, I think, make a fair point is that in the construction of the National Improvement Framework, they were influential in ensuring that we ended up with a framework that was based fundamentally on teacher professional judgment, which is what we have, because it is an aggregation of the achievement of levels data that is contributed each year in June by individual teachers around the country.
But what puzzles us sometimes, I think, is I was looking back this morning at an exchange at First Minister's Questions between Liz Smith and the First Minister, when Ms Smith asked about the removal or the abolition of the SSLN and how we would have national level information about the performance of our education system. And the First Minister said that SSLN had been replaced by SNSA, which she argued was superior because it wasn't a sample, it was a census of all pupils. That completely contradicts what you've just said.
But I think the argument I'm advancing is that that picture is constructed by the levels data.
I'm sorry, but the argument the First Minister was advancing was a different one.
But if I go back to what the First Minister said when she launched the programme for government in 2015, the First Minister, if I get the quote in front of me, the First Minister was crystal clear about what the purpose of this all was. Just, if Mr Gray gives me a second. The First Minister said, the assessments will inform, not replace, teacher judgment. They will provide robust and consistent evidence to help teachers judge whether a child is achieving the required level of curriculum for excellence. The new assessments will introduce greater consistency to curriculum for excellence. They will provide reliable evidence of a child's performance or progress, but they will not be the sole measurement. So that was what the First Minister said on the 1st of September 2015 when she launched the programme for government, which included, for the first time, the commitment to SNSAs.
I read that quote this morning, but I also read the quote from her from June 2018, where she's very clear that this is a replacement for the SSLN. And I think what the committee has found puzzling and has asked some of the witnesses about is how it can be both of those things. And the witnesses have been quite clear that it can't be both of those things.
Well, I think what's important is that we vest our analysis in the quote I've just read out from the First Minister in September 2015. Because what the First Minister was saying there is that the SNSAs will contribute to the formulation of teacher judgment. And the teacher judgment will then be aggregated into the achievement of level data, which will be aggregated at national level. And we will have a more comprehensive picture of the performance of young people within the education system and their achievement of levels than the SSLN as a limited survey could ever have given us. And okay, that's the squaring of the argument that Mr Gray is wrestling with.
Okay, I'm not sure how we're supposed to know which quotes of the First Minister we're supposed to accept as correct and which ones we're supposed to discount, but let's leave that for another time. Does that not mean then that we now have no statistically rigorous information about the performance of the school system as a whole at a national level, information which previously was provided in a statistically rigorous way by the SSLN and has now gone?
I think we have got a statistically rigorous analysis at national level of the performance of the education system because of the comprehensive data that we now collect on the achievement of CFE levels at early level, first, second and third level, which are reported nationally, openly on an annual basis. And that is a superior and more comprehensive analysis than an SSLN survey, which at most would identify the contribution of 2 primary 4 and 2 primary 7 pupils in each primary school in the country, and, if my memory serves me right, 12 pupils in a secondary school, in each secondary school in the country.
Sorry, did you say that we have national level information through summing the SNSA results?
No, through the presentation of the CFE levels data, which comes from teacher judgment.
That's right, but our witnesses have repeatedly said that that introduces some questions of moderation or statistical rigour.
Well, the SNSAs provide the statistical consistency and rigour to inform moderation across the country.
But they can't be summed nationally.
I'm not attempting to sum them nationally, because that's what I said, they are diagnostic. But what they do is they provide the moderation of performance across the system, which many teaching professionals have said to me has been a challenge through Curriculum for Excellence, and I think the committee has taken evidence that substantiates that point. And also, if you look at the evidence that Professor Patterson gave to the committee, the evidence that said that the SNSAs were statistically strong and robust to provide that consistency of moderation across the system, which then underpins the teacher level, the teacher judgment, which informs the performance data that we collect and aggregate nationally.
Another aspect of the difference between SSLN and the SNSAs, and indeed the CFE levels, which some witnesses brought up in the course of the evidence, was that SSLN was undertaken across both the state and private sector schools, but SNSA only happens in state sector schools. Now, given that the Scottish Government's main objective in education is to close the attainment gap, could you explain how removing a cohort largely, I think it's fair to assume, from the more privileged end of the pupil cohort from the data that's been collected can help to do that?
Because what we are looking at, you know, the purpose of the SNSA is to help to inform the diagnostic analysis of pupils' performance. Sure. That enables schools, and I think there is increasing evidence of that now, to be able to better focus on the individual challenges that young people face in achieving the CFE levels that we expect them to achieve. That puts a rigour into the education system, which I think is of benefit to individual teachers to assist pupils in improving their performance. And by improving pupils' performance, we have our best means of closing the attainment gap.
But how will we know if you're achieving that if a significant cohort at the privileged end has been removed from the data that you're collecting? We can't make that comparison any longer.
But what the data will be able to demonstrate is what levels are being achieved by young people within the Scottish education system, and that will demonstrate openly what improvements in capacity and performance they have, which as a consequence helps to demonstrate whether we are seeing the type of educational performance that we would expect to see coming out of young people within the education system.
But they won't be, because they'll be removing from the data a part of that education system, i.e. the independent sector.
But essentially what we are doing and the information that we present demonstrates what is the extent of the attainment gap within Scottish education,
yes.
And then we demonstrate year on year how we are closing that gap. So that's on, you know, comparable data year on year on a whole series of different indicators on which the government has consulted and has, I think, got to a position of broad consensus that the measures we tabulate indicate the framework for closing, within which the closure of the attainment gap should be undertaken.
But you're excluding from that data a group who, I think it's fair to say, we would expect to be at the higher end of the attainment gap because of their privileged position in the private sector. They're now no longer part of the data you're collecting to make the comparison that you've just described.
No, because the data that we are providing is looking at the performance of pupils across the education system, where the capturing of data on CFE levels will be captured and monitored year on year.
Across the public education system.
So we will demonstrate what progress has been made in that respect.
In the public part of the education system?
It will be, yes.
Yeah, okay, that's fine. Would all of this not have been simpler if the government had simply maintained the run of data provided by SSLN, even as they introduced SNSA, which, as you've explained at some length this morning, is for an entirely different purpose?
We have to be mindful, and the committee hears this very frequently, of what are the burdens on the education system. And the SSLN involves an additional burden on the education system. And what we judged was that we had to put in place a system which would enable us to provide for teachers the core diagnostic information, because all of the analysis, all of the guidance that we've looked at from the OECD makes it crystal clear. The OECD review of Scottish education 2015 makes it crystal clear that we did not have sufficient effective data at our disposal in the Scottish education system to be focused on how we were improving performance. So we had to put in place those arrangements to enable that to be undertaken. And our judgment was that that would be best served by introducing standardised assessments, moving to the capturing of CFE level data that would be valid and available in relation to all pupils within the education system. And then if we continued to capture SSLN, we would be asking the education system to generate ever more information when we had judged what was the information that would be useful and reliable to meet the tests supplied by the OECD report on Scottish education, which identified deficiencies in the information that we gather and collect on the performance of pupils within the education system below the senior phase.
But no witness in any of the evidence that we've heard has ever described SSLN as a burden on either the system or teachers. And indeed, EIS themselves have made quite clear that they felt the SSLN was proportionate and relatively easy to administer.
Well, I think what we had to address was the fact that the OECD report indicated to us significant deficiencies in the information that was available about the performance of individuals within the education system. And what the SSLN did not enable anyone to do, and I think Professor Sue Ellis was really pretty emphatic with the committee about this point, that the SSLN did not result in any scrutiny at local authority level about how to improve performance. And that's not a criticism of local authorities, it's just they wouldn't know where to start, because they wouldn't know the extent to which their authority or schools within their authority was in any way contributing to the challenge that might be highlighted by the SSLN. So what we realised we had to do something about that point, because there were not in place the mechanisms to assess that performance. So we put in place a performance framework which enabled us to do that, but in so doing did not want to add that onto existing arrangements that were within the education system, which is why we discontinued SSLN.
But what SSLN did provide was a degree of accountability with statistical rigour for government in terms of the performance of the education system. Haven't you thrown that baby out with the bathwater?
No, we've enhanced that because we have identified, because we've put in place a framework which requires the aggregation by teachers around the country based on professional judgment supported by the moderation offered by SNSAs of a nationwide, individual by individual constructed picture of the performance of the education system, which is much more comprehensive than anything that the SSLN was ever delivering for us.
But none of the evidence we've heard believed that to be the case at a national level. Even the evidence that was very supportive of a lot of the other points you've made about SNSA.
But my contention is that we have now available to us through the collection of that CFE level data, a much wider cross-section of information about the performance of the education system. And crucially, what underpins it is the ability to actually deliver enhancements in the the performance of young people, because of the fact that the data is driven by the judgment of individual teachers on individual pupils, which the SSLN, whatever that picture presented, did not provide an analysis or a route by which performance could be improved.
But the Scottish Government's own evidence to the committee says that the SNSA specifically is not for accountability purposes. But when I ask you about the accountability of government in delivering a success and improvements in their education system, you say that that is provided by data which is underpinned by SNSA. Do you understand why there is an ambiguity here about the purpose of the new assessment?
There's no ambiguity, because I resolved that ambiguity for Mr. Gray quite a while ago when I said that SNSAs were one part of information which were statistically reliable, consistent across the system, linked to the curriculum, linked to the benchmarks. All of these points were put on the record by Professor Patterson, which helps to inform teacher judgment in the creation of performance levels, which give us a much more comprehensive...
Let me finish my point.
Which gives us a much more comprehensive picture than was ever the case under SSLN, and the ability to interact to resolve those questions.
Cabinet Secretary, I'm going to bring in Mr. Scott.
Thank you, Convener. I'm just trying to understand, Cabinet Secretary, your points about the collection of national data, because the evidence that the committee were given on ACEL, your point about the levels on under Curriculum for Excellence, are, quote, badged as experimental. And the report on the statistics stated that over a third reported that they were generally confident in the robustness of that data. So by definition, two-thirds were not confident. Well, so how can you be so confident that you're building up that picture?
Well obviously, as with all data, there is a period that you have to go through to get to a point where statisticians will give you that that appropriate standard. And we're on course to that in that work, but it's underpinned by the robustness of the assistance to the moderation of performance, which I believe the SNSAs provide us in contributing towards enhancing teacher judgment, along with other interventions, I would add, about the training and the development that's undertaken by Education Scotland and local authorities.
So when do you think the ACEL information will be comparable? Which academic year would you expect that to be the case?
With the caveat that that's not a judgment that I can make, because it has to be made independently of me by statisticians. But my expectation is that probably in the next academic year we would see that being the case.
Because the 2017-18 report cautions against comparing the data across years. So you're expecting next year, 18-19 or 19-20, for the data to be
19-20, I would expect the data to... But I caveat that with the fact that it's not my decision to make, but that would be my expectation.
So that will be the first year in 19-20, and I take your caveat, entirely take your caveat, that we'll have a set of figures for the performance of Scotland's national education system, which we then build to compare in 2021 or 2022. Would that be correct in making that assumption? So in terms of all the interventions that have been made since national testing was introduced, it'll be 2021, 2022, 3, 4, 5 years before we can assess what has changed.
Well, there's obviously, we publish, as Mr. Scott will know, a range of information through the National Improvement Framework. We just did it in December, which tabulates a range of different indicators of the performance of the education system, which we believe, and we've consulted widely on this, to give us an assessment of actually represents the attainment gap within Scottish education. Now, we went to considerable trouble to consult on these questions to make sure that we had a comprehensive picture that would command confidence within the education system. So there is a lot of data in there that enables us to form a picture about the progress that's actually been made.
I'm sure that's entirely true. It's just you've laid very considerable stress this morning in your answers to Ian Gray and to the committee about ACEL. Very considerable stress, and therefore I judge by all the stress you've laid on that you consider that data to be the preeminent data in your ability as an education secretary to assess what's happening in Scottish education.
Well, with respect, we're having an inquiry here about standardised assessments and about the curriculum for excellence data, which is why much of the conversation has been concentrated on that point. If we'd started off today with me being asked a question about what would I be judging the closure of the attainment gap by, I would have vested my argument in a whole host of different factors which are already published and which give a very good and broad set of measurements as to how we're closing the we're working to close the poverty rate attainment gap.
I entirely take that point, I'm not going to go back into what the First Minister said or didn't say from earlier on, but the arguments that have been used to are all about we don't know what's going on. Government Parliament doesn't know enough of what's going on. I'm just suggesting that you have laid, I think understandably, considerable stress in the ACEL as your measure to produce enough data which tells us what's happening.
As part of that wider assessment of the closure of the attainment gap that's designed through the National Improvement Framework.
Okay. Can I just ask a couple of questions about the testing itself? In the evidence that's been laid in front of us by a variety of witnesses, I think it's fair to say that particularly at P1, but presumably at other levels as well, but the P1 was the point that was particularly made. Tests are taken at different times of year. They're taken with different levels of support. Some children are taken out of the classroom. Some children have the tests taken in class time. And teachers judge when these things are done and are appropriate. Would it be fair, therefore, to say that that's not standard at all across Scotland? Indeed, I think you've made that point frequently.
What I would say is that obviously it's the same assessment that is carried out. You know, in each year there is, the assessment doesn't change in the year. It changes from year to year. We've replenished a third of the questions from one year to the first year to the second. But the same assessment is undertaken. It is designed to assist with the. To give an idea of consistency to support the moderation process within the teaching profession. So it represents an opportunity to provide that assessment of the performance of individual young people. So it's an approach which, in my view, gives that consistency, which I think to me is a standardised assessment.
I just generally can't take the point about it being the same, because if children are taking it at different times of year and they are getting different levels of support, that's not the same, is it? It can't possibly be considered to be the same, statistically or in any other way.
It will be because of the fact that we are confident through the norming studies that we have done that the assessment is a true reflection of the level that individual children are expected to be achieving, and therefore it gives a teacher an insight into how close to or far away or what are the relevant issues a child is facing in the achievement of a particular CFE level, and that will then ultimately inform the data that is recorded and upon which we place the emphasis for assessing the performance of individual young people in the system.
I can accept that it's about where a child is and how a particular child is doing in respect of a level. I can get that. But if child A takes that test in November and child B takes that test in the spring of the year, and child A does the test with all the other children in the classroom, and child B does the test outside with a support teacher helping him or her through that process, that is not the same, is it?
But that's
what's happening. That's the reality of Scottish education.
But that's an argument for relying on teacher judgment about how best to utilise this resource to identify the performance of young people and the diagnostic issues that need to be addressed. And I think that's well left to individual teachers to make that judgment, in my view, because the purpose of this assessment is not a summative purpose. And we've been very clear about that. It's not to identify who's passed or who's failed. Mm-hmm. It's to provide an analysis in the teacher's judgment during the year. Mm-hmm. At what point is it best for me to assess whether this child is in command of the level of that's being mm-hmm. assessed? And in some circumstances, a teacher may take the judgment that to do it early in the year will provide them with good diagnostic information about what they've got to try to do in the remainder of the year to satisfy themselves that the child is actually achieving that level. Mm-hmm. In other circumstances, a teacher may say, well, actually, I'm best to leave this till later on. I've got a mm-hmm. fair sense about what this individual child requires, and we'll concentrate on that and then undertake the assessment to see if some of those issues have been addressed and what else flows from it. So it's ultimately, for me, a matter of teacher judgment.
Yeah, I agree with that, but my argument is it's not standardised.
It is standardised because it's the same assessment that is being undertaken.
OK, I feel I'm darting on the head of a pin, so I'll stop. Can I just... One last question, if I may. I agreed with your comments about Renfrew. I think they were published on Monday about Renfrew and closing the attainment gap. But in... And this was the BBC report, so it may not be fully... It may not have reflected everything that you said, but in nowhere in this report about Renfrewshire closing the attainment gap is school testing mentioned, is standardised testing mentioned. There were lots of things which I recognise as extremely sensible that are being done there about helping young people to develop and to grow. But in all of this, three pages of quotes from lots of different people, no mention of standardised testing. I would just wonder what the link was. I mean, if we're to be convinced this is so important for the future of education, it doesn't even get a mention in an area that's obviously made some considerable progress in closing the attainment gap.
Well, obviously, the data that is collected is there to provide a comparability of performance over time about the progress that we are making that informs the wider performance information in the National Improvement Framework. Now, the fact that the news reports about Renfrewshire don't make reference to that is a matter for the compilation of news reports, but fundamentally...
The First Minister didn't. But your quote didn't.
Well, but fundamentally, what we are looking at...
I was agreeing with your quote, doesn't mention it.
What we're fundamentally looking at is the contribution in these particular reports that are made by individual local authorities and schools to, in a very focused way, to meeting what are our expectations in the Scottish Attainment Challenge, which are about closing the poverty-related attainment gap.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
A quick supplementary from Ms. Gilruth.
Turn to Tavish Scott's line of questioning there, and he argued that the SNSAs were not standardised. So what happened prior to the SNSAs? And I think 28 out of 32 different local authorities used some form of assessment. Was any of that standardised? Do we know how many of them, for example, were benchmarked against Curriculum for Excellence previously?
There were 29 local authorities who ran some form of standardised assessments, but they were not standardised from... each local authority to another, and they were not standardised to, they were not bespoke to the curriculum in Scotland. So invariably they were products that local authorities bought in to provide some form of moderation within those local authority areas about the performance of young people. But they were not related to the curriculum, and they were not related to other local authorities.
Uh-huh. And also to return to Ian Gray's point on the SSLN, I think Ian Gray alluded to the EIS who said it wasn't a burden. Previously, when I was in the classroom, it was actually a pain in the neck, if I'm honest, having a group of children removed from your class during the context of a lesson, because you would then have to revisit the content that you'd covered in that lesson. It was quite disruptive to teaching and learning. So Sue Ellis told the committee previously that the only people I heard talking about the SSLN were politicians and the odd academic. Does the SNSA offer an opportunity to track individual pupil progress, which the SSLN couldn't do?
Yes, that's the fundamental point about SNSAs. They are related to the performance of individual young people. and they are there for diagnostic purposes to assist teachers in supporting young people to achieve CFE levels, and then as a consequence, that improvement of itself helps to improve the performance of the Scottish education system.
And just briefly then, is there a cultural challenge, do you think, in Scottish education whereby, I suppose, data is for academics and politicians and it's not for teachers?
Well, actually, I think that if that is a cultural problem, I think it's changing. Mm-hmm. Because I hear increasingly, I think it's very obvious in the feedback from Her Majesty's Inspectorate about the greater utilisation of data within the classroom to identify particular challenges that children face and to use that data to assist in a variety of purposes, not least of which is in closing the poverty-related attainment gap. So there is I think, very clear evidence that the system is becoming much more focused on the utilisation of data for a purpose, the purpose of which is to improve the performance of individual young people. And as a consequence of that, we will see improvement in the performance of the whole education system.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Greer?
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to return to the evidence previously submitted by the EIS. They quite clearly made the case that some of the issues that have arisen, or some of the concern that's been raised with SNSAs, has been as a result of local authorities not following the guidance that was agreed and issued at the start of the process. Many local authorities haven't followed guidance that's been issued since then. Cabinet Secretary, do you believe that's because the local authorities disagree with what is in the guidance, or is it because there's still confusion about the SNSAs, confusion about the purpose, or confusion about the guidance itself? Because they either disagree or they are confused as to what the guidance is telling them.
I think probably the answer, respectfully, is probably in neither. I think it's because we're in early days, to be honest. This is the first year that we've had SNSAs, and I think there has been, I think, some established practices which would have been used under the old standardised assessment arrangements that local authorities would have run, would have perhaps on the one issue, one of the principal issues the EIS has raised its concerns about, has been about a window for undertaking the assessments. And the guidance is very clear that there should be no window prescribed. It should be up to teacher judgment. I think a number of local authorities have kind of rolled forward their previous arrangements, which did use a window. So I think it's because we're in the early days. Some of the points, as I made clear in one of the contributions I made to Parliament, we have reinforced that guidance to local authorities, and I would expect there to be changes and differences in performance and approach as we see these assessments rolled out over future years.
The window issues is quite an interesting example of this. You'll be aware that the committee, in the course of this inquiry, had written to local authorities. You've probably seen a lot of the responses we received. Inverclyde Councils was quite a notable one on exactly that. I'll just quote very briefly from it. They said, "The authority does not support the idea of," and they quote, "testing a pupil when they are ready," end quote, "as the tests are not designed to be used this way. We are also wary of individual teachers choosing to test pupils late in the academic year because this may give the best perceived results." So Inverclyde do set a window of between January and March. Do you agree that that contributes towards a culture of high stakes testing?
I think a window between January and March is, in my view, a pretty big window. If it was the first 2 weeks in March, I would think that's a real window. I think a three-month period, we're beginning to get into the territory of, I think, stretching some of the definitional issues that are here. I don't actually think that Inverclyde position of 3 months is particularly unreasonable. But I would say within that, teachers should be making a judgment about when to undertake that assessment.
Part of the issue that had been raised previously, I'm sure that teachers have mentioned it to a number of members and yourself, is about, and it comes back to this fundamental tension between formative and summative assessment, and teachers' concern about how standardised this is, how comparable the data may be. And the example that Tavish Scott gave is a very relevant one, of particularly in primary one, some pupils taking the SNSA at the start of primary one will be 4.5 years old. Others who take it at the end of primary one will be 6 years old. There's obviously a significant difference in development between a 4.5 year old and a 6 year old. If the purpose of this was entirely about a teacher's judgment and information that they could glean for that individual pupil, then that would not be an issue. But there's clearly an impression, or at least confusion, about how this data is used at any level beyond the individual, whether it's classroom level, school level, local authority, or nationally. Do you recognise that there's a concern there about the validity of data that's aggregated at any level beyond the individual pupil when there are these inconsistencies?
I think we've got to get these messages clear and clearly understood. Yes, I accept that, which is why in my opening remarks I said that, you know, we're 1 year into this, and you know, there may well be lessons we've got to learn, that we've got to strengthen communication about these points. But what I hope that I can do with the committee this morning is explain where the SNSAs fit in to the wider assessment of performance of the Scottish education system. And fundamentally, the SNSA is there to assist with a diagnostic assessment by an individual teacher, which will then help to inform practice and performance in relation to individual children, which ultimately will contribute towards a definition of whether a child has reached a CFE level, and that information will then be aggregated. Now, I appreciate the sensitivities of all of these questions, because I have absolutely no interest in the aggregation of data for the kind of purposes that get many of these systems into disrepute. That's why I'm heartened by some of the assessments that the judgments that are made about what we are doing by people like Andy Hargreaves or by Alison Skerritt, who are saying that we're trying to do something different. Because what we're fundamentally trying to do here is to provide in the classroom an approach which helps teachers within Curriculum for Excellence to have greater advice and support in the moderation of the performance of young people, to diagnose to undertake a diagnosis of their performance and support them to overcome any challenges that arise out of that. And that is the means by which we are trying to drive improvements in the performance of the education system, because we won't drive improvements in the performance of the education system if we don't drive individual improvements in performance for individuals.
That at the level of the individual, Cabinet Secretary, you said yourself that there is a step in this process at which data is aggregated. But the question that's been raised is how comparable is that data? How valid is the aggregate data when you have inconsistencies of, for example, at primary one, an 18-month gap in development between children who've taken the SNSA?
Where the aggregation comes is that fundamentally, at different stages in our curriculum, we judge it at early level, first level, second level, and third level, we make a judgment about whether young people have reached that level. And I appreciate that there will be young people at early level, first, second, third, will be at different ages as they are going through that process. That's just a fact of life. But fundamentally, we have to make a judgment as to whether or not the needs of young people are being achieved. And that information will be publicly reported as part of the reporting that we undertake.
I'm still confused about
basis.
The validity of the aggregate data here, because it could be about the issue of the age gap, or it could be the other issues that Tavish Scott has raised about inconsistencies and the circumstances under which the test is taken about. I absolutely accept what you're saying. I would disagree to some extent, but I accept what you're saying about the use to an individual teacher of the data gleaned on an individual pupil and how they can adjust that pupil's learning experience. But at any level of aggregation, this is not entirely standardised data. So any level of aggregation is going to have issues with the validity of the data. But you've not yet explained how those issues are resolved. You have explained that that data is aggregated, though.
So well, they're resolved in the reporting, because essentially in the reporting of the crude SNSA data at a national level, it will give a profile of how performance is being delivered across a variety of different indicators and different elements of the assessment. But then ultimately, the assessment that really matters to us is whether young people have reached the particular level within curriculum for excellence. And that is informed not just by SNSAs, but by a whole variety of other
absolutely, but mechanisms. SNSAs are one of the data points there, and I'm questioning the yes. validity of that data once aggregated.
Essentially the reporting demonstrates the range of performance against those the particular elements of assessment within the SNSA, but fundamentally it flows into the aggregation of data on the curriculum for excellence levels, which is the assessment that matters to us as to whether young people are in command of the details of the curriculum.
And just one final question, convener. How is that not summative? What if that's being aggregated, how is that not summative?
Well, that part of it is ultimately a summative.
So the SNSAs are both formative and summative?
Well, in that aggregation of data, it's summative. But the purpose of it is to be a formative assessment.
I think that's a fundamental tension, but I recognise how much time I've taken up, and I'm sure other members will want to follow up on that.
But that is the character of the SNSA. It is a formative assessment because it leads to a diagnostic assessment.
It's a formative assessment that leads to summative assessment data.
Well, only because of the ultimate aggregation of the data.
Exactly.
Okay, quick supplementary from Ms. Mackay.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I just wanted to pick up on Ross Greer's point about high stakes and the tests possibly being high stakes. The government has consistently said that the tests are not high stakes, and Professor Hargreaves, during evidence, agreed with this. Do you think that some of the narrative surrounding these tests being played out has skewed the purpose and meaning of these tests?
I think there is an active debate. Indeed, we looked at this debate very carefully about the nature of standardised assessment. You know, the 2011 report on standardised assessment by the OECD is a report which carefully maps out the benefits and the dangers of standardised assessment. And what the, you know, if I identified the, you know, some of the learning that we took from the report, the 2011 student standardised testing current practices in OECD countries and a literature review, identified a number of themes and key lessons that countries had to be mindful of if they went down a route of standardised assessment. They didn't in any way say standardised assessments are not appropriate, but they did say there are dangers which can end up creating that image and impression of a high-stakes approach, whereas what we founded our view on was the analysis undertaken again by the OECD in 2015, where they said that standardised assessment tools can be used formatively in all parts of the system if they are referenced to the curriculum, which ours is, flexible in their use, which I would contend ours is, and provide high-quality, just-in-time information for teaching and learning, which I would contend is the case, while at the same time having efficient ways to aggregate the results through the system. So that was the advice we got from the OECD in 2015, and I would contend in every characteristic we have followed it. And that was advice that was a derivative of a report from the OECD which said there are merits in standardised assessments, but you have to be careful about some of the details of your implementation, which we have taken great care to be to make sure was the case.
Okay, thank you.
Ms. Smith. Thank you. Mr. Swinney, you have quite rightly said in committees past that you have ultimate responsibility for what goes on in the schools across Scotland, and I think every parent sees you as the person who has responsibility for raising attainment. Can I ask you, in light of the discussion that we've had about the purpose of these assessments, that I think we accept what you're saying in terms of their prime focus being on formative and diagnostic assessment, but you've just admitted that there is a summative purpose as well. Could you explain to the committee how the Scottish Government will be looking at the evidence of these SNSAs in the future, particularly if you see schools or local authorities who have an underperformance. What would you be looking for in terms of evidence to support comments that might mean that that school or that local authority has to improve matters?
Well, fundamentally, the approach that I'm bringing to the education system is that I want to create a constantly improving education system. That is my mantra. And everything I'm doing is trying to support that objective. So whether it's a school inspection, the chief inspector, I welcome the focus of the chief inspector, which is on ensuring that inspection is about driving improvement within our education system. The work that we're undertaking through regional improvement collaboratives is about improvement, about improving professional learning, about improving standards that are taken forward, about improving pedagogy. The work on being taken forward through the attainment challenge is very focused on creating an improving system. So I want to ensure that we have a relentlessly improving, I think in previous appearances before this committee, I've said that I had a relentless focus on improvement, and that's exactly what drives the agenda that we're pursuing.
Could I just ask, though, in the context of your previous comments today, that the SNSAs, in your opinion, will provide an enhanced assessment of the youngsters in our schools? And you've also made very clear that you expect, because of that enhancement, that there will be a better focus and hopefully a better attainment at the levels of the curriculum for excellence. Could I ask you how that information would be used by the Scottish Government, or what would your expectation be in a local authority to use that evidence?
I think it's important that I take this right, answering this question, take it right back to the individual children. You know, we will not have an improving education system in Scotland if the education and the performance of children is not improving. So therefore, the improvement has to be felt within an individual classroom, which is why in my answer a moment ago to Jenny Gilruth, I talked about the greater utilisation of data within the education system to identify where improvement required to be made child by child, because the improvement in the system is not an amorphous thing that floats about in the ether. It is driven by what is the performance of individual children, which is why we've opted to ask for teachers' judgment about the satisfactory achievement of levels at the different levels of CFE, because essentially what the OECD said to us was that, and I paraphrase their words, but we were essentially pretty blind on individual performance across the system until the senior phase. And that's the gap we have remedied here. And we've remedied it by reliance on a teacher judgment about whether a CFE level has been achieved. One part of the information base that informs that is SNSAs. So fundamentally, it's not just about me being focused on improvement or even local authorities, it's individual class teachers having the available data to help them to improve the performance of young people's education. And obviously my job is to make sure that the education system is well supported and well resourced to enable that work to be undertaken at classroom level.
Just to pursue the point about the role that you have, which you've rightly identified, if you felt through the inspection reports that you'd received that one or two local authorities weren't performing as well as you had hoped, and there were clearly some issues, would it be the curriculum for excellence levels in that local authority across their schools that you're looking for in order to try to help to support that local authority to improve? Or are there other aspects
There would be a variety of information I would look at. I've looked at one local authority.
Could you spell out what it is?
Well, for example, I have looked very carefully and Education, Her Majesty's Inspectorate, have published on this, that the performance of one local authority very specifically, which was causing concern, that was Argyll and Bute Council, and a lot of information that this predates the availability of the CFE levels data, but there was a general concern about the performance of the local authority. I asked, the inspectors looked at that, they published requirements for improvement on that local authority, and to the credit of Argyll and Bute Council, they have responded positively to that call. So I would be looking at, and obviously I have powers in statute which enable me to do that if it is required, but obviously I'd be looking at a range of data and information, and CFE levels would undoubtedly be part of that judgment.
Final question.
Can I just put that in a kind of wider context, that actually what in trying to create a constantly improving education system, I want to see local authorities bought into and participating in that journey of improvement and leading that journey of improvement, supported by the Scottish Government. And I think the willingness of local authorities to work with us on the standardised assessments, for example, because actually this is a tremendous local authority collaboration in introducing standardised assessments. Why? Because for some of the reasons that the exchange I had with Jenny Gilruth is relevant, individual local authorities may have been undertaking some form of assessment, but it wasn't related to curriculum for excellence, and it couldn't give them any read across as to whether what they were doing in local authority A was at a sufficiently comparable standard to what was going on in local authority B or across the whole of the country, which of course standardised assessments now help to inform that judgment by local authorities.
Thank you for that. I think my final question goes back to the point you raised in your introduction to the committee this morning, which is about what the OECD said, and despite the many strengths of Scottish education, it did highlight this issue about the richness of data, and it made some suggestions about what we should do to enhance that richness, and you yourself have said that one of the reasons for introducing these new standardised assessments is precisely that. At the same time, however, you did actually, or the Scottish Government, took out Scotland from other measurements, principally the Pearls and the Thames measurements. Could you explain, in the light of what the OECD was saying when we didn't have enough evidence and data, could you explain what the Scottish Government's thinking was to take Scotland out of these other measurements?
Well, some of those decisions are quite historic, if I remember correctly. But I think the relevant quote here is from the OECD, and which is relevant to this answer. And it's from their 2015 report at page 155. The light sampling of literacy and numeracy at the national level has not provided sufficient evidence for other stakeholders to use in their own evaluative activities or for national agencies to identify with confidence the areas of strength in the years of the broad general education across the four capacities of CFE, nor has it allowed identification of those aspects or localities where intervention might be needed. Now, I think that's essentially a commentary on what the SSLN delivered for us, and that would be my assessment about some of the international work as well, that it doesn't give us an insight into what actually needs to be done to improve the system, which the current framework that we've put in place enables us to do.
But you would accept that some of the experts who've been in front of this committee, Professor Hargreaves being one and Lindsay Patterson and some of the others, have made very clear that these international measurements are actually important.
Well, we subscribe to some international assessments, as Liz Smith will know, but our judgment was that we had to focus on the international judgments that were relevant and appropriate for us in balance with the other changes we had to make in relation to enhancing data within our own system.
Okay, someone. Okay.
Thank you very much. Can I, first of all, you've made quite a lot of talking about formative assessment and the importance of standardised assessment and that. Professor Dylan Williams is an expert on formative assessment, most people would agree with that, and he says that these tests would have little, if any, formative use. Do you have a view on why he might say that?
Well, I can't speak for Professor Williams, but what
you
I can...
You would accept he's an expert in his field?
I acknowledge his support for formative assessments.
He disagrees with what you're saying about the purpose of these assessments.
Well, yeah, but you know, lots of people disagree with lots of people in education. What I've... You know, if I can perhaps help...
So we get to pick our experts, do we?
Well, if I can, if mm-hmm. I can, if I can,
I'm just asking you.
Well, if
you
I
don't
can,
agree with them.
Well, I think this is a good system, and Professor Williams. I'm not sure of the extent to which Professor Williams has studied our particular system that we've introduced. I don't know that question, but what I would say to Joanne Lamont is to refer her to the expert opinion that informed our judgments, which was in the OECD report at page 157, where. They said, standardised assessment tools can be used formatively in all parts of the system if they are referenced to the curriculum, flexible in their use, and provide high-quality, just-in-time information for teaching and learning, while at the same time having efficient ways to aggregate the results through the system. Now, there is expert opinion from the OECD, which I would contend we have followed to the letter in making the judgments that we've taken forward.
Okay, so I suppose what we're now testing or probing on is whether what you've put in place meets that purpose. So can I go back to this question of standardised testing and the fact that, you know, young people could do them under different conditions at different times? A child could be 4.5 when they start primary one. They could be 6 by the time they finish primary one. They could be in a class of 2 or 3 young people being supported individually to sit the test, or they could be sitting in a bank of 30 children with a laptop or an iPad or whatever is in front of them. In what way is that standardised? So we take the 4.5-year-old doing the test on their own without any support, and a 6-year-old fully supported with weeks of practice, and your own officials told me that they were allowed to practice beforehand. What would be standardised about the results of those tests?
Because they are undertaking the same assessment, they are being supported appropriately within the context of their learning, which is one of the important parts of the...
Could you explain what that means?
I mean that assessment is an integral part of learning within the education system. I think anybody would acknowledge that that is a key part and characteristic of the system, so therefore it's being undertaken within recognisable classroom conditions with the, you know, the support that any young person would ordinarily get for their education, and they provide consistent reporting and diagnostic information on individual
young people. Can you explain to me how it's consistent classroom conditions for a child of 4.5 to be doing this test in a group of 30, and a child of 6 to be doing it with one individual supporting them. How is that the same classroom conditions?
It's
theoretically the same test. If I'm doing a test, a driving test with a car that doesn't work on my own, with no support whatsoever, no lessons, against somebody who's been supported all the way through it, these are very different things.
I'd venture to suggest that the example that Joanne Lamont presents there is a ridiculous example in the context of the performance of a classroom teacher.
A classroom teacher would never, ever conduct
an assessment in that fashion.
Well, you explain to me a 4.5-year-old in a class of 30 doing that test without practice, how can that possibly be the same as a child of 6 doing with one person supporting them, having had a lot of practice?
Because fundamentally, it is the same assessment that is being undertaken by every child. And what the purpose, in proper classroom conditions, with appropriate support, not in the example that Joanne Lamont cited to me, that a child would be undertaking their learning, so that it wasn't something that seemed different or unusual. And if you actually look at the, if the committee members look at the practitioner feedback is that they wanted to deploy these assessments as part of the learning process of children in the classroom, which one day might have a child working with support or independently with a piece of technology, and then on another day be invited to do this particular assessment using the self-same piece of technology with, I would imagine, a degree of supervision, because it would be, I think, unusual for a five-year-old child to be undertaking such a process without appropriate supervision. Now, obviously, when you get to P4 or P7 or S3, which this inquiry is looking at as well, you get into very different circumstances where young people have got greater capacity to do these things independently, and so
but
they should have.
You would reflect on the fact that even those people who came before the committee to advocate standardised testing said this bit of it, where there was this complete flexibility, meant that actually that notion of standardised information come out of it would be a bit of a challenge. Can I ask you also an example I gave of the benefits of it as a diagnostic test, because I think we know the challenges around that. There's one question we were shown where a child had to identify the word that rhymed with another word. There's a little button, and if you press the little button, you can hear it. And I asked, at the presentation that you put on for us, and we were very grateful for it, was there any distinction made in the reporting of that between the child who could identify the word without hearing it and the child who couldn't identify it without hearing it? And I was told, no, there would be no such distinction. When I raised that with experts before the committee, they said that that was problematic because that wasn't given the information that was of any benefit. How can it possibly be a valid test where you're not even in this theoretical diagnostic formative mode making a distinction between a child who can read without hearing a word and a child who needs to hear it in order to understand whether it's a rhyme word or not?
Okay. I'm going to invite David Leng, who Mr. Leng was the former Director of Education in Stirling and Clackmannanshire, who's the professional advisor on this programme. It's a question of a level of detail, which I think it would be appropriate that David Leng gave a view upon.
Good morning, everybody. I recognise the question. I think I was part of the demonstration that we gave to you in that one. It was a question about a word to do rhymed with pie, if I remember correctly. The point of the standardised assessments is an adaptive assessment. So the assessment questions progress through the range of skills, in this particular case, literacy skills for primary ones. The question you were talking about was particularly assessing phonological awareness, which was about basically whether or not they could identify a sound with another sound. Whether or not they were able to read that or listen to it for that particular question was not key. What was key was their ability to make the phonological identification. And therefore, children were able to give them that choice. It was a supportive process. If they were able to read it, fine. If they wished to listen to it, fine. It didn't. That was not the significant part. The part you're talking about, the decoding of a question, that is the ability to be able to read a question and understand what it means, comes later in the assessment. And so what happens when the teacher gets feedback is they get feedback on the particular skill that the question is seeking to assess. And so what you have is a range, and so many of you will remember there were some questions later in the assessment where they were asked to read without any audio support, and some of the children found that quite challenging. Others found it straightforward, and that enabled us to identify, therefore, which children were able to do that decoding. So what you have is a range of questions. They go through those range of questions. They're being asked certain key skills, and the assessment builds on that, and it adapts to their ability level. So to take one question to ask whether or not you need to know the audio or not isn't the point. The question is whether the whole assessment will tell the teacher how well a child is able to deal with or not audio or visual stimulus, and that's what they do get. And if you've seen the report, and I know you have seen examples of it, that's very clear in the outcome that comes. Not the specific support, but the skill that the child was being assessed on, the level of difficulty of the question, and whether or not they were able to do it.
So have you factored into the assessment the extent to which a child would be comfortable navigating themselves around the system as well? So I think we were told at the presentation that there was lots of opportunities and people could have practice and so on. Will the test reveal the extent to which there's been that support so the child understands the way around the system? Does that make a difference? Have you factored that into the report? An individual school level, the teacher will know how much support. Yeah. But in order to say, in a standardised level, and to kind of make that comparison a reasonable one, you would need to know, surely, whether there was a lot of support beforehand, a lot of practice or not, or is this something that you don't think distorts the results in any way?
Well, we go back to the purposes of the assessment, and we've said all along that they are diagnostic and their primary purposes at a school level. So what we've tried to do is to build flexibility and support at that school level. And therefore, in a sense, the teacher makes the decision how much level of support they're going to provide. The rich information, therefore, is at the individual level. I've heard a lot of discussion this morning about aggregation and at what point does it, you know, what we've been very clear about is support the child, ensure the child goes through this in as comfortable and in an easy way as they can, give them the support that they require, because what we're assessing is their ability on elements of the literacy or the numeracy, not on the, if you like, manipulation of the actual assessment tool. And then when you're looking at the reports, you understand the level of support that was provided. The teacher does,
right,
and the school does. And therefore, any aggregation that they may make is based on that understanding of the support the child was therefore given. And the standardisation is therefore about the assessment, the questions, the matching to the curriculum, the common reporting, the common scaling that they're on. It's not about exact same conditions or exact same timing. And that's a different understanding of standardisation.
So it certainly is. I get the point that it makes sense at a local level. People can look at different... I get that. But it's a question of whether this can do the two things at once. And I think that is really one of the challenges. And I've not heard anything convincing here that says there's a rig around both. You see, well, there's all this... The teacher knows exactly what support was in and therefore contextualises it. But how that possibly then feeds it through to a government level, I'm not sure. But, I mean, I think that's something perhaps that's come out of the evidence. Can I maybe, in conclusion, maybe ask the Cabinet Secretary this question about the SSLN? You said it didn't give sufficient information. I think maybe people could accept that. Is that grounds, first of all, for therefore getting rid of it? But secondly, when you have to say that we've got rid of the SSLN, because it's deemed to be a burden, when at the same time there are significant reports of the burden created by standardised testing in taking senior management staff from their work in order to support the classroom, learning support staff being taken out in order to ensure that these tests are done, and a lot of anecdotal evidence that there is a consequence to running these tests which has created a burden. Can you... First of all, on this question of it's not sufficient, would you accept it might not be sufficient? That's not grounds in itself for getting rid of it. And if it is about the burden that is created, have you been able to quantify what that burden is? Because it sounds to me like it would be the equivalent of, I don't know, groups of kids taken from out class, out for an hour. It's the same annoyance and inconvenience that teachers face all the time when there's a school show on or whatever it might be. Have you been able to quantify what that burden was that led you to decide you needed to drop the SSLN?
On the first point, the judgment in relation to SSLN was that we were essentially moving to a more comprehensive collection of data about the performance within the education system.
I don't want to interrupt you. Did you at any point consider, like, having a transition period? We've heard from Tavish Scott at the ACL, it's not really going to be something you could look at to what, 1920? Did you think of a transition period even, when this is not sufficient, so it's not perfect, but it's at least giving you information in the meantime? Did you at any point consider a transition period so that you would continue it until the other process was in place? Or is this burden so overwhelming that you decided it was necessary to get rid of it, and what was the quantity? Did you quantify
What we considered was the potential to expand the SSLN to provide us with some of that information that would address the gaps clearly identified by the OECD. So we gave very close consideration. Indeed, that was the initial first option that the government was looking at, to expand the SSLN, because it had that, you know, it had a degree of longevity about it, to try to ensure that we got that more comprehensive picture. But to do that, our judgment was we would create an approach within the education system that would have been even more significant than the measures that we have in fact opted for. And one of the reasons why we opted for these measures was that many local authorities, 29 out of 32, were operating some form of standardised assessments. But as I explained earlier on, those local authorities carried with them a frustration that they were operating these individually, they weren't related to the curriculum, and they also were not providing moderation of standards across a wider canvas. Mm-hmm. So the local authority may have been making an assessment to the best of their ability in relation to the curriculum, but they were doing so without a bespoke assessment mechanism, and they had no basis of moderation across local authority boundaries. So we were essentially putting in place a replacement for all of that, although I accept that in some local authority areas, I think for good reason, some local authorities are continuing with their previous systems in a limited number of cases because of the line of sight that they are interested in establishing in that respect. And I think the final point I would make is that we ultimately are trying to fulfil the objective of enhancing the information that's available to ensure that we can support young people in the improvement of their own performance. And that's why we've taken the decisions that we've taken.
But this issue about the burden of the SSLN, what was the burden of taking a sample group of young people out across the system for one?
Well, it's another part. You know, I constantly wrestle with the issues about workload.
So you quantified it as what?
Well, I didn't quantify it, no.
Right.
Because,
it wasn't really about the burden then.
Well, of course it is, and I didn't quantify it by doing a sum. What I did was I made a judgment that this was not necessary because of the fact that we were opting for more comprehensive reporting of the performance of young people, which would address the key challenges set out in the OECD report. And I'm mindful at all times, and I'm under constant pressure about this, to remove things from schools when we are asking schools to do different things. And I felt, on balance, the right thing to do was to discontinue SSLN.
But with no suggestion, serious suggestion, that the SSLN in itself was creating a burden, but the removal of it has created a gap in the information currently available while the new system goes into place.
I think John Lamont is being cavalier with the question about burdens in schools.
Oh, no. Not at all.
Well, I'm
I'm asking you, one of the serious questions around this is displacement of people supporting individual young people into running a series of tests. It's entirely legitimate for me to ask you, what was the burden that SSLN created, which was so great that meant there is now a gap in the information? What? Your own experts have said, support you in this, have said that they think the SSLN could continue in an amended form. And of all the issues around this that I'm concerned about, burden is one of them, and you must always balance burden against purpose. And I'm asking you, what was such a burden on SSLN in comparison with the level of burden that the standardised testing has created for many folk inside the education system?
Well, John Lamont has just said that we have to balance burden with purpose. Mm-hmm. And I made that judgment about SSLN in the judgment between burden and purpose. And with the pressure that I am constantly under to remove burdens from schools, I judged that the right thing to do was to remove SSLN because we were moving to a more comprehensive performance measurement system. And I'm constantly focused on how I can remove burdens from individual schools. I cannot afford to be cavalier about that question.
And no one is cavalier about it. With respect of all the arguments you put forward today, that is the least credible, that the reason we're getting rid of SSLN is because of burdens. And everybody in this committee is very conscious of the level of burden on teaching and support staff in our schools.
I'm going to move on to Dr. Allen.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. One of the things you've mentioned today has been about making sure that new assessments align with the curriculum, and indeed the government's submission to the committee mentioned that alignment to the Scottish curriculum is also key for Scottish teachers and sets the SNSA apart from other standardised assessments previously used in schools. I wonder, can you say a bit more, however, about what the process was in deciding how to make that alignment and whether you're satisfied that it's there?
I think what we've gone through in the implementation of Curriculum for Excellence, a number of steps to essentially ensure that the system was well informed about what the different staging posts and levels were envisaged to be and the progress that children and young people would make through the curriculum. That discussion has been informed over time by the production of experiences and outcomes which provide a shape and a framework of the curriculum. That remains a major part of the judgments that teachers make about the content of the curriculum. But I certainly detected a level of concern within the teaching profession when I came to office that there was not sufficient clarity in the profession about what individual levels would be represented by. So I asked Education Scotland to do some work on the creation of benchmarks which were designed to give a clarity about what individual levels looked like, as opposed to prescribing what had to be the contents of those levels. The feedback I get from the profession is that benchmarks have now made a significant impact in stabilising that understanding of what levels are, and as a consequence, the profession is more confident about what levels look like. Having said so, against that background, SNSEs then had to be set within the context of those benchmarks, and also the material and the contents of them judged by our education specialists to be appropriate. And it was the blending of that education advice with the content of the Curriculum for Excellence benchmarks that has given us the approach that we are taking. But obviously that is kept under review with the replenishment of questions that are undertaken in each of the assessments.
You said something there about levels and about the structure of Curriculum for Excellence, but obviously Curriculum for Excellence, as you well know, is about more than that. It's about a philosophy, about pedagogy. How does that fit in with some of the comments across, if you like, the spectrum of views that's been made about how the assessments fit in with the philosophy behind Primary 1 play-based learning?
I think it's important that we remember, we highlight just the very title that Dr. Allen refers to there, which is play-based learning. There is the play-based approach within the early level is designed to ensure that young people are able to have command of the learning that that they would be expected to acquire as part of the early level. The play-based approach is a medium through which they are undertaking that learning. So the assessments have got to operate in a fashion that are consistent with that approach. That's one of the questions that I've asked David Reedy in his assessment, his independent assessment of the P1 assessments to challenge and to tackle as to whether or not we have got that approach correct. But fundamentally, the assessments are there to consider whether young people have got command of the learning that would be expected to be undertaken as part of the early level acquired through that play-based approach.
In putting those things together, the play-based learning and the approach to the assessment, however, how do you ensure that the breadth of what's being tested is relevant in terms of producing information in Primary 1?
I think we've got to be clear that the standardised assessments only capture or address a part of the literacy and numeracy elements of the curriculum. And of course, the curriculum is much broader than that. So they consider and assist in the diagnosis of challenges that young people will face in that respect. But ultimately, teachers have to make a more comprehensive, holistic judgment about whether a young person has got command of the CFE levels, which will be the case by the judgment that's applied by individual teachers in the reporting that's undertaken on CFE levels.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Gilruth, did you want back in?
It's a couple of questions. Thank you, Convener, briefly. It's with regard to teacher training. Professor Hargreaves previously told us about developing a collaborative culture in teaching, and we've spoken today about moderation and, you know, having a better understanding of shared standards. And he also said the profession needed a role in informing the continuing development of the SNSAs. Is that the government intention going forward?
Yes. Obviously, this fits into the wider work that we are undertaking to create a more collaborative climate within Scottish education. So the regional improvement collaboratives are now gaining more significant momentum, and as a consequence are beginning now to influence and enhance classroom practice. So that more collaborative climate is crucial to how we advance our agenda in education. In a number of different respects, we engage the profession on our learning from the assessments in a very direct way. The P1 practitioner forum that I established is doing really good work, I think, in engaging with practitioners about the experience of undertaking the assessments in P1 and to help us to identify what are some of the challenges that have to be addressed. But obviously we are capturing the opinions and views of members of the teaching profession about how they are taking forward the implementation of the assessments more generally, and we are undertaking some extensive survey work of teachers to gauge their experience in that respect, and obviously we'll reflect on that as we take forward further developments of the assessments.
So on the teacher training front, I know that Scholar have developed a programme with Heriot Watt University, and I think 95% rated satisfactory, but obviously that's an online training programme, I think, and there's the GTCS training package as well. Are you looking then to develop a more consistent approach more at a national level, or perhaps through the collaboratives, to training teachers in the use of SNSAs?
That's what I envisage being undertaken within regional improvement collaboratives. We see work being undertaken on that in different collaboratives. The West Partnership has undertaken some of this work, particularly in relation to moderation, which remains, you know, I think moderation will perhaps always be a challenge within the system, and particularly within the nature of curriculum for excellence. But I certainly want to see the steps being taken to ensure that these programmes have an effect on the classroom, that the profession feels strengthened by the ability to have access to this type of training, and that it's considered as part of the professional learning of the teaching profession.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Mundell.
Thank you, Convener. I wondered if I could first go back to the points David Leng made in relation to Joanne Lamont's question around the around those specific questions with the button that you can hear. I'm 29 now. I've got dyspraxia. I know that I've got a problem with reading, and I'm prone to making stupid mistakes. If you'd asked me that at 4 or 5, I wouldn't have known that, and I'd have been quite confident in my own reading ability and my ability to go along the line and read a simple, short question. Do you not recognise there is a difference in the result the test shows based on whether or not I know to press the button to listen, to check and confirm that my reading was correct?
I'll ask you later.
I think the thing we've tried to stress all along is that I'm assuming your teacher knew you well and what your ability was in the classroom. This assessment
No, they didn't. I didn't get a formal diagnosis till further on in school. I wouldn't have known, and nor would the teacher at that point, that I would have found that difficult.
Okay. These assessments, first of all, I want to say categorically, are not about assessing whether or not children have additional support needs. That's not the purpose of them. That's not the precision, if you like, of the tool. However, what they will is indicate to the teacher particular developmental and mental needs you may or may not have. Okay, that's the diagnostic process of it. That will then be added to the teacher's knowledge of you and all your other work that you are doing. And that's why we've stressed all along that this assessment does not, it's indicative of ability that you have at a particular moment in time. It indicates to the teacher for further exploration. It does not definitively say this child can or cannot do this.
You do accept that the variability and adaptive nature of the test comes with a risk and that that is a risk that certain specific learning difficulties or particular learning styles or patterns could be disguised by adaptive features within the test. There is a risk.
I think the point here, Mr. Mandel, is that the assessments are trying to establish the developmental capabilities and challenges that an individual may have in their education.
Can I just pull you up just when you say developmental? I find that that's a sort of confusing term to use, really, because when people talk about a developmental test, they're not really looking at whether someone's achieving certain points in the curriculum. I think in the nature of this conversation, you would be then looking at a different type of developmental test to assess those things like they use in other countries. Okay. And that we heard from certain witnesses.
Forgive me if I've used the wrong terminology, but essentially what the assessments are trying to do is to find out what are the areas of further development that will arise out of the diagnostic assessment that are made. In my earlier remarks, I talked about areas where a teacher may identify greater or lesser capacity within a young person, given the evidence that is thrown up by the undertaking
I accept that, but my question really is, does the adaptive nature of the test in some cases come with a risk that certain, because of the design of the test and design of the question, that certain difficulties a child is facing in their learning might be disguised or might not be as obvious as if the test or questions were done in a different way?
I think where I was trying to get to in my answer is to say that I think the and I would rather not consider this in a specific fashion.
That's why I asked your official rather than yourself, but in relation to a particular question.
No, but it's the point I'm trying to make is that I think the analysis, the diagnostic assessment that is undertaken as a consequence or that arises out of this assessment may give rise to a number of points of inquiry by education professionals, which may say to them, which may be big questions as to why a young person may not be able to handle particular elements of the assessment as well as one might have expected them to be able to handle them. So it won't provide a diagnosis of a particular condition, but it may give rise to a series of questions about how do we need to configure the learning of this young person to ensure that they can achieve their full potential? And that may then open up a whole series of other questions.
I understand that argument, but by the same logic, is it not entirely possible that through the design of the test, you could find a false positive that would close off lines of inquiry that otherwise, through the teacher's individual judgment, they might have thought, they might have been more likely to pick up? Whereas this test, particularly the adaptive nature, the time-related nature, the different possibilities for how you complete the questions, that can actually present a false positive in terms of how well the pupil performs, and particularly for bright pupils who maybe have a specific learning difficulty, the teacher might be inclined to think they were a middling student and doing okay, and close off lines of inquiry that if they'd done a diagnostic test, as was suggested by some witnesses, particularly at that early stage, it might have helped pick up the actual needs of the child better.
I think fundamentally this question relates to the ultimate question that has been answered here, which is the teacher's professional judgment about the child. That the SNSA informs that process, but does not dictate it. It is determined by the professional judgment of the teacher. Now, in that context, a teacher would have to take into account a whole range of different information and experience about the educational performance and contribution of a child, given the focus that we have within our system on getting it right for every child, would you potentially beg several questions about what were the needs of this child and how could they best be met, which is fundamentally the judgment that we look to educators to make within our system.
if the test is poorly designed and features within the test make it more difficult for teachers to exercise that judgment, is that not a problem?
Well, we've got to, we obviously nobody wants that to be the case. I don't think it's the case in terms of the assessments that we have undertaken, but it's obviously I'm not going to say that we are impervious to that. I would want to make sure
what specific analysis was done to ensure that these tests were suitable for young people with additional support needs. What assessment was made of them? What evidence from experts did you solicit ahead of introducing them and suggesting that they would be a good thing for all children to take at age 4.5 to 6?
It was one of our key principles at the beginning that we were as inclusive as possible. So we took steps to involve experts in this field. So we used Call Scotland. We had a reference group of additional support needs experts. We did trialling with children in special schools and in mainstream schools who had additional support needs. We had one-to-one what were called cognitive labs, which were how children were actually interacting with the assessment. So we made every effort we could to ensure that we included as many children as possible and were able to give useful information across the spectrum of abilities that are in our classrooms. We do accept that that's a very big ask, that one standard assessment can cover every single child in Scotland. So it is an ambition, it's an aspiration, and we continue to take feedback and to, in a sense, continually improve that process. But it was a very serious attempt by calling in expert reference groups and by testing and trialling questions prior to them being released to be as inclusive as possible. And what the feedback we got was that this is significantly more inclusive than any other standardised assessment that had been currently used in the Scottish system. So we've made progress. I'm not going to claim 100%, but I think we are making the right moves in that direction.
And would you be willing to share those expert views and analysis of the questions and tests with the committee?
Most of it was done the short answer is I'm happy to share with what they shared with us. Most of it was very practical. It was, you know, sitting, looking at assessments and comments, and we had Scottish Government accessibility people also looking at it. I'm happy to make that available.
Okay, thank you. And then just a final question for the Cabinet Secretary, and that was, can you understand why myself and other colleagues in the Parliament might be angry and irritated that during the debate we had on this topic that some members of the Parliament chose to suggest that these tests could be used for the diagnosis of additional support needs? Can you see why that would cause confusion and annoyance?
I understand that point, yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Mundell. Can I just finish by asking you a question, Cabinet Secretary, about the way forward for standardising assessments? One of the areas that's been discussed in detail is about the time constraints on schools and the technology available to them and how they've been able to implement this. However, we were lucky enough to have a focus group with some teachers there, and on asking them about the previous standardised assessments were being brought in either at local authority or school level, if there was any addition, how they managed the time around those tests. And basically the answer that came back was that, you know, it was exactly the same. You know, they had to accommodate all these kind of tests within the curriculum. It was something they were used to. In Maree Council, in their submission, have stated technology hadn't been an issue because most of the schools were following procedures in place for previous assessments. And indeed, North Lanarkshire, representing my own area, have stated that it's universally accepted that real benefits in SNSAs and that any issues encountered in the first year of implementation can be overcome in the subsequent session. Are you content that, you know, this is being embedded in schools and there isn't a particular issue in terms of resource and time for teachers, and that you know, lessons will have been learned from the first set of test of assessments that have been taking place?
I think the first, you know, this is the, you know, we're just in year two. In year one, there was a theoretical maximum of pupils that could be, assessments that could be undertaken of 613,000. And in fact, 578,000 were undertaken, which was a completion rate in excess of 94%. So on a first year implementation, and given the fact that there is, you know, we have taken the view that obviously it's up to individual schools to judge whether it's appropriate and suitable for pupils to be undertaking the assessment. So some pupils would not be given the assessment. 94% in year one on a new system, I feel, is a pretty high level of participation. If I look at the data as of yesterday, 144,941 assessments have been taken during this academic year. At the same date last year, it was 119,616. So there's a really quite significant increase in the proportion of assessments being undertaken by the 19th of February this year. So it's 144,941 this year, compared to 119,616 last year at this date. So I think that's indicative that the system is adjusting to these and taking them forward. I have to say that in all of the work that I take forward, I'm not always able to reach agreement readily with local government about many questions. Local government was very supportive and participative in taking forward the SNSAs because of the issues that I raise about the fact that the assessments they were undertaking, through no fault of their own, were not curriculum related and did not support moderation effectively. So local authority have actually embraced this very significantly, and obviously to get a 94% participation rate, schools would have had to have embraced these readily as well. So I think we're making progress, and obviously I'm, you know, as with any new approach that we take, we have to be open to doing things better or differently, and I'm open to that. It's why we're taking forward the P1 Practitioner Forum. It's why we've taken feedback extensively from teachers and also from pupils about their experience, and why we'll continue to do so.
Okay. I think we have a final question from Ms. Mackay. Thanks.
Professor Louise Hayward of Glasgow University said the idea of having information from tests that support teachers' professional judgment is an entirely appropriate approach. So just relating to what Oliver Mundell was saying, I mean, friends have said to me that they wish these tests were available when their children were young. So do you agree that this test is an assessment which will enable parents just to know at a general level how their child is doing, and it will confirm teachers' professional judgment, and that we're in danger of overcomplicating the meaning of these tests?
Fundamentally, it could be up to individual teachers to make a judgment about what information they shared with parents about the performance of children through the SNSA. If a parent was interested in that information, I could see no reason why that shouldn't be shared with them as to how their child had performed, and particularly about what issues come out of that, about particular strengths or particular challenges, because ultimately if there's a challenge a young person has got which has been identified by a diagnostic assessment, there can be valuable parental support that could be motivated to ensure that through school and parental support that challenge could be overcome for an individual child. Ultimately, I think schools will be reporting on whether or not children are achieving levels, where they are in that journey. That is those are the milestones of the broad general education, and that information, obviously our objective is to enhance the quality of that information by virtue of the robustness of the SNSAs.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your attendance. It's been a long session today, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you to your officials. We'll now move into private session.